Welcome to Podcasts Across Worlds. I'm your host, Lehua Superfina.
And I'm the co-host, Spirit, aka Papa Fulu.
We are people who like to read a lot of manga and watch a lot of anime. We realize that we all like similar titles and we could talk about them for hours. So here we are in Podcasts Across Worlds to talk about anime, manga, and everything else we're interested in. So what prompted you to bring the topic of that time I was reincarnated as a slime?
Because I've just read the newest chapter.
I know, right? The newest chapter. Oh my gosh, it was what I wanted. Veldora the Storm Dragon is back.
And it turned out that because of Veldora, that's why Rimuru was able to name as many monsters as he was.
Yeah, because he had all that, were they calling magic mana?
Magicules.
Yeah. Oh, I just thought Rimuru was he had just unlimited.
Yeah, it turns out it's because of Veldora.
That's cool. I'm really impressed that they did that connection, and it was like that makes a lot of sense.
Reason I also thought of it, you know, when we were talking about Beastars and we're talking about the manga and the anime, and we were mainly focusing on the first season.
Correct, yes.
If we talk about this, we could actually talk about that. The story gripped us. Like, did you start with the anime?
No, I didn't.
I was going to say, I started with the anime, and that's what made me read the manga. And I know we've talked about slime a lot, and I'm like, why don't we just do an episode talking about this?
Oh, yeah. Actually, this is what started it. This is what started the idea to have a podcast together.
It was talking about that time I was reincarnated as a slime.
Okay, so you asked if I saw the anime. I thought you meant like season two of the anime. Season two?
Oh, no, season one.
So I actually started reading the manga, and then when it came out in anime, I was like, fuck yeah, the anime's here. This story's awesome. This deserves an anime. Yes. I was very excited.
So, I think it's kind of poetic as well that this is the episode that we should talk about, because this is what started the idea of having a podcast.
Yes.
Plus, I just want to talk about slime because that new chapter was so good.
Oh, yes. Okay, so let's talk about what that time I was reincarnated as a slime is about. Mm-hmm. So, this story is about a man in Tokyo who died, and he was given the opportunity to be reincarnated in another world, but he was reincarnated as a slime.
Well, the thing was, he didn't know that's what he was doing. Like, when he was dying, he was like, oh, I feel so cold, and it's like, okay, cold resistance added, and then heat resistance added, then extra skill, temperature control added.
That was happening because that's what he was feeling when he was dying.
Yeah, I'm saying, but when he chose to be a slime. These were all the things that were happening when he was dying, which ended up as being the slime. Like, that's how he ended up, like, with pain nullification and the slime body and regeneration.
He has a, what is it, a divine figure in his head?
Well, it turns out to be the great sage, because he's like, oh, they say if a person reaches the age of 30 and they're still a virgin, they're a wizard. And the fact that he's almost pushing 40, he may as well be a great sage. And that's how he got the skill great sage.
Okay, so Rimuru has the great sage in him, in his mind, in his brain, integrated in his whole being. And as Rimuru was dying as a human, before he was transported to the other world, Rimuru was feeling all kinds of stuff. He was feeling the sensations of dying, feeling cold, and then feeling hot, and then feeling pain.
And the blood, and it says a body without blood. Is that my blood?
Oh,
and
yes.
So he gets that's why he gets the slime body.
And so all of that stuff that he was feeling before he fully died and transported to the other world, all of that was used as buffs and skills in his slime form that was determined because of all those sensations. And he has the great sage infused with him. So every time he encounters something, he can ask a question, and there is a limitless of information available for him.
Yeah, and the fact that even Great Sage can be snarky when he's asking questions, don't ask me.
Oh, I love that. It's so sassy. And it's interesting how it's portrayed sort of like a computer has like that polygon thing going on that's being... That was the image of it, but I think that's being portrayed because that's how Rimuru is seeing it, because he's not used to the whole magic cues, magic stuff. That's how he's imagining it.
Yeah, because it's like when you're talking to an Alexa or a Siri device.
Yeah.
It's that sort of thing you get, but in the latest chapter, well, the latest translated chapter, it's now the ultimate skill, Raphael.
Okay, that was... unexpected for me. I did not see that coming. I was like, oh, I thought you were the Great Sage. I thought you were a bodiless being, but then all of a sudden you have a form? Oh my. What's going to happen next?
And Veldora's got a human body now.
Yeah. Okay, so let's talk about Veldora for the listeners who don't know this story very well.
Yeah, Veldora the Storm Dragon was the protector of the Great Forest of Jura. But when you first encounter him, Rimuru's a blind slime after just coming around and not having any senses. So he's just starts off gobbling up Hokte herbs and Magistone.
Yeah.
Magiro. I'm not too sure. It's Magicule infused. And he meets Veldora. It's so funny the fact that Veldora just wants a friend because he's been trapped in unlimited imprisonment for, I can't remember how many years now. And it's said that he's just going to die once his magical energy leaves. It was unlimited imprisonment, I think. Who the hero trapped him.
Yeah, a hero trapped him because Veldora, you know, he was doing his own dragon thing and he was considered as a threat. And so a hero came along and entrapped him in this crystal prison that Veldora couldn't get out of. And he's been trapped there for years, let's say hundreds of years. He's lonely. And this powerful dragon, this powerful being decides to be friends with a slime that who he thought was inferior to him. But because he's so lonely, he's like, I enjoy our conversations. I can talk to someone. You got interesting stories, slime. I got my own story. Yeah, let's talk. And then the slime, he feels the danger from this dragon, but he's like, whatever. The great sage says, I'm okay.
Yeah, because it's due to Veldora being trapped there and the magical's leaking, why the cave's full of Hohokte herbs and the magiculo.
And with the dragon being there, just like as a side note, the dragon being there, it acted as a type of, the magicule from the dragon acted like a type of barrier, repellent for anyone from entering that certain forest. I believe that was happening.
It wasn't so much the entering the forest, it was the fact that his presence was known about and he was seen as the guardian of the forest. So people didn't want to overstep their boundary and take over. Because if you notice when Rimuru ate Veldora and that presence was gone, that's when they're all thought, okay, we can take it over.
Right. They didn't feel his presence. They were like, oh, it's free for all now. It is land that can be taken.
But what I found weird about Veldora is in the latest translated chapter was the fact that beings like that don't have a physical form.
What do you mean? And
it says that the form that Veldora had after Rimuru ate him, it was like, oh, I didn't need that anymore, so I just discarded it. And I turned it back into magicules.
Ah, I see.
And that's why when Rimuru created his clone and Veldora went into it, he was able to because he didn't have a physical form at that point. And so when he entered it, it made it his own thing.
That's what I liked about it. Okay, so the slime, so Rimuru ate Veldora just to store him until Rimuru could find a way to release Veldora because the slime wanted to try to free Veldora from the unbreakable prison. But the slime didn't know how. He didn't have the power. He didn't have the knowledge. So what he did was he used his skill, Predator, to devour Veldora. But he also stored Veldora someplace in his slime body self and just carried him until Rimuru had the power and knowledge, I guess, knowledge to release Veldora for it to be safe. So what Spirit is talking about is Rimuru finally was able to release Veldora. Veldora didn't have a body. So after oh so long, the slime is able to make a clone. So the slime made a clone of his body, gave it to Veldora. And when Veldora inhabited it, Veldora changed it to the way he wanted it to look. Like, it's like they fused the personalities of Rimuru and Veldora. And it's kind of trippy because it looks like they're related, which makes their friendship much closer.
Well, they do share the family name of Tempest.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of curious if they are going to be introduced as family. One thing I thought was really funny, the fact that Rimuru wants to apologize to Veldora after freeing him and all that. He's like, oh, well, maybe if you give me some of those cream puffs, we'll be even.
Oh, that was so cute. Veldora is so curious because he was stored. He was stored inside Rimuru. He was able to filter through Rimuru's memories and see what was happening. And Rimuru was doing all kinds of stuff, man. He was introducing things that was in Japan to this monster world. He was giving people recipes, inventions. He was just creating a whole new thing. He was being innovative in this new world. And all of this was fascinating to Veldora. And he's like, when can I get out and experience all this? Especially those cream puffs. Those look delicious.
Oh, I don't know if it's in the manga because I started reading after season one's content, but the fact of when after Rimuru ate Diablo, or was it Ifrit?
Ifrit. Diablo yeah, was summoned.
After he ate Ifrit, was it turned out inside Rimuru's slime stuff because Veldora is talking to that. They're playing Shogi!
Yeah! Veldora's like, hey, want to play this with me?
That's what they're doing the entire time.
Now, so that was in the manga. So if you're wondering, viewers, listeners, if you're wondering who Ifrit is, Ifrit was a fire spirit that inhabited this girl. And Rimuru devoured Ifrit. I thought Ifrit would just, you know, disappear, dissolve in Rimuru. But no, Ifrit was stored in the same era as Veldora. And Veldora was like, hey, company, want to play Shogi with me? And Ifrit's like, oh my gosh, there's an enemy, fight! And he couldn't do shit. So Ifrit's like, sure, I'll play Shogi with you. What is this place? And Veldora's like, explain what's going on. He's reminiscing everything, and he's just retelling the whole story of Rimuru to Ifrit. And Ifrit's like, great. Like, he's so nonchalant. Now, Ifrit's inside of Rimuru. Veldora was let out. The question is, will Ifrit be let out too?
I don't know, because I know Rimuru has all the skills of Ifrit now.
Right.
He's got the skills of what was the Great Orc Disaster.
Mm-hmm.
That fight was really good in the anime.
That's the one where he was fighting the Onis, right?
No, that's the one where he was fighting the Orc.
Oh, yes.
The one where you couldn't satiate his hunger. And he was always hungry. And was it Gelmude? The Margin that was playing the orcs against the dragon folks because Gabiru was hoping that he would get some help. He's like, your job is to get eaten. Because it turned out Gelmude was the one who named Gabiru and also Rigurd, who was the goblin that they said died against the direwolves. So it seemed like there was a plan to get all of them eaten and create a new demon lord who was going to be the Great Orc Disaster.
Right. So for the listeners, we're going to explain what is going on over here. So we're in this new world. Rimuru is a slime. Coincidentally, he's in an area where there's monsters. It's like the monster area of this world. And there's a system going on. There's regular monsters, basics, the ones you see in games and stories and such. They seem mindless. They seem like they're just doing what they're programmed to do. And then you do see monsters that have a mind of their own. They're leaders. They command the monsters and such. Now, in this story, that time I was reincarnated as a slime, there's a system where if a monster has enough magic use, power, you know, he has a certain, he or she has a certain intelligence, and they are able to bestow a name onto another monster. This is the system that I'm going to be talking about. The monster is bestowed a name, and this monster is able to evolve. They evolve physically, mentally, and skill-wise.
If you're going to get into that, you also have to mention the fact that in this world, monsters do not have names. They are able to communicate with each other without names whatsoever.
And with that, they're still able to function in this world without names. And then once they get a name, it's like they're given another purpose. I'm not too sure what that purpose is, but they are able to get more powerful. They don't have a threshold anymore. They can evolve higher up to, I believe, a demon lord, maybe beyond demon lord. But there's a system going on.
The way it's gone out with the different levels, I kind of believe that there is a level above demon lord.
I think so too, because there's too many demon lords. There has to be something above that to dominate all of them.
So for the evolution, when they get the names, you've got the goblins become hobgoblins and goblinas. Ogres become Kijin. The orcs, can't remember what the orcs become. Oh well, the orcs become something. The dragon men end up getting wings, and some of them end up looking human. Like Gabiru's sister, who's so after Soe.
Oh, that's the interesting part. Okay, let's talk about that one. So the dragon-like monsters. So it's interesting. Like, remember when I said the monsters get a purpose? So with these dragon monsters, the ones who got names, some of them kept their original form, and some of them evolved to a different form that looked more human, a little bit more attractive. And both of these types of monsters, they do different things. So the ones that turn into more human, more pretty, beautiful, handsome, they get more stealth, I want to say.
I don't know if it's to get more stealth, but they're the ones that Rimuru tells Soe to train so he has more shinobi.
Yeah, so they become more shinobi, and I guess with that skill, they're able to do more stuff, like, say, for example, infiltrate areas. Because they look more human, they can pass off as human. So it's sort of like whatever the monster wants to do, their evolution will reflect on that. So, for example, the sister, the dragon girl, she likes Soe. And I guess because she liked him so much, her desire to be with him and be like him affected her evolution. And for some reason, it affected other people's evolution too, which worked out because now Rimuru has more shinobis. Yay!
You know what the best evolution is, don't you? When Shion got reincarnated, she could finally cook.
Oh gosh.
Oh, that was a running joke throughout the entire series. But the fact that after she got reincarnated, she can now cook.
Oh, we're gonna get back to that. We're gonna get back to that and explain why she got reincarnated and why she can cook now. Okay, so Rimuru is the one who's been naming all these monsters here. If you didn't understand that, or if you didn't guess that, so Rimuru has been the one who's been naming all these monsters, letting them evolve, and it's been revealed at the latest chapter that's been translated that the reason why Rimuru has been able to do that is because of Veldora's magicule. And we didn't know that until that chapter. So that was really interesting, because what happens is whenever Rimuru names a monster, it takes the magicule, it depletes Rimuru's energy. And then if he exhausts too much, then he falls asleep. He goes into sleep mode, needs to recharge for a few days. And at first we thought it was like that because Rimuru just had limitless magic cube. But no, it was Veldora's this whole time.
And that's also infected the speed and the rate at which the monsters have evolved.
And after Rimuru named all these monsters, they all pledge allegiance to him. And not Rimuru's choice, they decided to make a community. They're like, we are going to protect him. He's our leader. He's wonderful. Praise Rimuru. Praise Rimuru Tempest. And Rimuru's like, I just wanted to relax, enjoy my life. You guys are just appointing me as a leader, but I guess I will. I feel a little responsible for you guys. I guess I'll take this role. All right, let's go. Let's do this. And then one thing after another was just thrown at him. Oh, can we go over how he started interacting with that kingdom that had the dwarves? How did that happen?
Oh, the kingdom that's run by, is it Gazelle Dwargo?
Yeah.
Well, the goblins needed to trade, and I think it was... This was after the whole goblin direwolf fiasco. And they needed to go and trade, and Rimuru and the other direwolf riders went off to the city of Dwargo. I don't know if that's what it's called, I'm just calling it that. And it was him and Gobta who went into the city.
They went into the city, something happened... I don't remember what it was, but...
It was the reason they... Well, they had to go in. They ended up talking to people. They ended up meeting Kaijin, who was the forger, and he had to create so many magic swords. Because that person... I can't think of the person's name, but the person who worked for the leader of the Dwarven City said that he had to do so, otherwise... I can't remember what the consequence would be, but he had a prejudice against... Kaijin, and he was the reason that Kaijin was no longer holding the position of authority, and he's now just a blacksmith. But there was the scuffle in the bar after that guy poured beer over Rimuru's head, and Kaijin just stood up and punched him, so they were thrown in prison.
They were thrown into prison, and then they were on trial, and that's when the king met them.
Because they originally wanted, the defendant... Well, their lawyer they had was working against them and was going to get them thrown in the mines. I think Kaijin for 30 years or 20 years, and his accomplices for 10 years less than him. Because Kaijin had already told Rimuru that he'd go with him because he helped him create these swords. Because Kaijin had to create these out of magical ore, and Rimuru just copied one, and he spat out the rest of them for him.
So this is from Rimuru's ability, Predator. This is from Rimuru's ability of Predator. He's able to devour something and mimic the appearance and skills. So he can do that to animate objects, inanimate objects, and living things. And he did that with swords. So because Rimuru liked Kaijin. So he took him back to his village.
Rhymes with hygiene, Kaijin.
Took him back to his village. He's like, I need a good blacksmith. I want you. Come back. We need to develop this village because I got plans. If I'm going to be the leader of this community, I have plans. I do not want to stay basic grass shack village. I want a city. I want tall buildings, skyscrapers. Rimuru had dreams. So he took the blacksmith back, and they were able to develop bigger, better houses. It was becoming more structured. And then the threat of orcs was on its way.
The threat of orcs, but before they found out about the orcs, it was the ogres. They fought the ogres, but the ogres fought that Rimuru was the margin that set the orcs after them. That's why they decided to fight him. And Rimuru was like, no, it's not me. Like, the old guy ended up cutting off his arm. And like, oh, I was aiming for your head. And Rimuru just picks up his arm, reattaches it. And like, oh, okay.
He's like, I'm a slime, motherfucker. I can regenerate. Slice all please you like.
It. Please keep that in.
Oh, yeah, I am. Definitely.
I'm a slime, motherfucker.
For the listeners, let's explain why the ogres were feared and why they were fighting with Rimuru.
The ogres are attacking. Well, Rimuru has a mask, and it turns out the people there's people that are called Margin. I don't know what distinguishes them from other people yet. I'm not too sure. And the ogres notice Rimuru's mask, and they assume that he's the Margin that set the orcs after their village, because Shion, Shuna, Soe, Benimaru, the old guy, and the blacksmith. There's literally six people left out their entire village. And they assume Rimuru was the Margin that set the orcs after and wiped everyone out. And the orcs are just going around killing everyone and eating everyone because they've got an unfillable hunger. And because they assume Rimuru's doing this, they attack him without cause. And Rimuru's trying to assess the situation, saying, look, this isn't me. And quite a decent fight plays out in the anime. And because of all this situation, the ogres decide to team up with Rimuru until the end of the whole orc situation that's going on. And the orc situation is trying to bring around the great orc disaster, which is going to be a demon lord.
So we talk about the ogres and we talk about the orcs. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about how Rimuru got the mask. So Rimuru got the mask from
Shizu. And Shizu is a person that was summoned from Japan.
Yeah.
And while doing so, she was infused with the spirit of Ifrit.
Okay, I got it. Okay. So Rimuru, the mask that he was wearing that the ogres mistaken for, the mask that he was wearing, he got it from Shizu. Shizu is a girl who was summoned to this world by a demon lord. A demon lord summoned her. We aren't too sure what was the full purpose of it, but she was protecting this demon lord. But because she was summoned, her magicules were like all haywire. And if she didn't control it, she would die. So what the demon lord did, he infused the fire spirit Ifrit to her so her magicules could be stabilized. For some reason, she lived a long time. She was immortal, right? She
had the appearance of a woman maybe in her early 20s. And she was summoned during the bombing of Tokyo, which was around 1945, I believe.
So Shizu came from a warring time and she was summoned to this world to fight for a demon lord. She had to survive. That was her whole thing. And she was in a foreign area. She didn't know what to do. So her purpose was to defend this demon lord. And then some point in her life, she was separated from the demon lord. She was abandoned by him. She was abandoned to fight off the enemy and to die, because the demon lord didn't think she was going to survive. But the enemy turned out to be a hero, and the hero's like, hey, you don't have to do this anymore. You don't have a master anymore. Be your own self. And so Shizu had a new purpose. She traveled around the world. She found other people who were summoned to. She helped people. And during her journey, she encounters Rimuru. And they have a bond because Rimuru was reincarnated from Tokyo, Japan, and Shizu was summoned from Japan. So they have that bond. And Shizu's magicules was going haywire again. Ifrit was taking over. And so Rimuru had to help Shizu by defeating her, devour Ifrit. But by doing that, Shizu's immortality is gone. And her body's catching up to her body. Her body's catching up to her and she's dying. She's getting older. She's dying. And Shizu's last request was for Rimuru to eat her.
Devour her.
Use the predator ability and devour her. And so Rimuru was able to mimic her body. And so now Rimuru has a human body. He has a human form. He's not a slime or a monster all the time. He has a human form. And that is how he's interacting with people.
But after Rimuru eats Shizu, in her moments in the slime stomach, she has a flashback where she's with her mother. That was a really sweet moment.
Yeah, I was like, oh, she had her happy ending.
And the mask that Rimuru got from Shizu, Shizu got from the legendary hero, who was the one who imprisoned Veldora.
Yep, so everything's connected, guys. things are connecting. And the mask's purpose was to hide the aura, so people wouldn't be able to sense that person, or so that person wouldn't scare others.
Yeah, it hired the magical presence. As when you first see Rimuru interact with the goblins, they're scared of him but also want the help because he's giving off an immense pressure. You can tell how strong he is, and no one seems to believe he's actually a slime.
And the reason why he was emitting all these magic cues was because of Veldora. So let's see. How was she introduced in the story? Because that's, I feel like Malim, I feel like her introduction sort of set the motion of the story to a certain direction.
Definitely brought the whole demon lord idea into the forefront, questioning why Rimuru doesn't want to be a demon lord.
Oh, I remember now. Okay, so let's see. The dryad of the forest that the monsters were residing in, and Rimuru has a family name. He came in with a family name called Tempest, which was influenced...
Tempest due to Storm Dragon.
Yeah, it was influenced by Storm Dragon because Storm Dragon, Veldora, and Rimuru, they wanted to have like a family name to be connected, and Rimuru decided on Tempest. Okay, we are Veldora Tempest, Rimuru Tempest. And the community that Rimuru is developing, nurturing, maintaining, he called it
Jura Tempest Federation.
Which would be explained later on. What happened was Rimuru and his fellow monsters, they fight the orc that is...
The Great Orc Disaster.
Yeah, they fight the Great Orc of Disaster because they're trying to save their home. And they were warned by the Dryad of the Forest. The Dryad of the Forest asked him, please help us. It's like, sure, we'll help. We're going to help anyway because we don't want to die. Rimuru defeats the Great Orc of Disaster. This caught the eyes of the Demon Lords. Especially the demon lord that was manipulating all this, that created that Great Orc of Disaster. And amongst the demon lords, we have this character, Spirit. Talk about her. She's your favorite.
She's not my favorite. I just like the fact of how she interacts and how they meet and how Rimuru manages to coax out a draw from her. Malim just wants to fight. She just wants to fight strong things. And when she finds out about Rimuru and the... city of the country of Tempest and the capital city called Rimuru, because Riga decided that. Riga's one of my favorite characters in that show. And Malim goes and she just wants to say hello. Someone starts a fight and Malim's just fighting back and just wants to have fun, but no one can hold anything towards her. And Rimuru's like, I know what I'm gonna do here. I've got this. And charges what looks like an energy ball in his hand. Runs at her and pushes it into her face. And you just see, like, delight appear in her eyes. Like, oh my god, what's this? I need more. And it turns out it was honey. He shoved honey into her mouth. And Rima was like, oh, well, if you admit defeat, I'll give you some more. And she's like, I don't know. But because demon lords don't like losing. And he's like, how about we call it a draw?
More like she doesn't like to lose. I mean, she's in it to win it. She wants to be the best. She wants to fight the best and be the best. She would not admit defeat. She's like, no, how about a draw?
Yeah, boy, it's over, honey. That was so funny.
And
the fact that food's now her go-to.
Well, the thing was, Rimuru was inventing food that no one has ever tasted. Had before, because he was taking all the knowledge he had from Tokyo and he was reinventing it into this world. So I believe sugar was the only sweet ingredient in this world, and I believe he was using bee monsters to create the honey.
And after the whole honey situation, which, guys, if you've never seen the anime or read the manga, you need to do so, it's so good. Takes her back to the city of Tempest, which at this point is a full-fledged city due to all the orcs now coming and living there and helping build. Because after killing the Great Orc Disaster, whose name's Geld, Rimuru said after also eating him, he took on all of his sins and is now responsible for all the orcs. And He named how, was it around 50,000 of them?
He named a lot. A lot. He
named all the orcs over so many days and appointed Geld's son as the now chief of the orcs, because what Rimuru does is he's in charge, but he delegates stuff to everyone else because he really doesn't want to deal with it. And after taking Malene back to the place, she's like, I'm going to live here from today. And Rimuru was like, what? They decide the fact that having the Demon Lord on their side would be good. And Rimuru's like, from today on, we're besties for resties.
And best friends don't kill each other, right? So Malene never had a best friend before. And
I don't think she ever had a friend before.
Well, they told her a story later on how she became a Demon Lord. Her story, so Demon Lords aren't boring. Like I said before, there's a system. So Demon Lords, people become a Demon Lord, but there's requirements. And they explain Malim's story of how she became a Demon Lord. Apparently she had a dragon pet, a dragon friend, and it got killed. They didn't explain how it got killed, but she was so sad, so angry that she destroyed thousands of people. And by doing that, she fulfilled a requirement to become a Demon Lord. And when a monster becomes a Demon Lord, they have a wish that can be granted, or they can raise the dead. With that power from the residue of a demon evolution, all that magicule can raise the dead. And so Malene was able to bring back her dragon friend, but the dragon friend didn't turn out the same. It sort of explains why she wants friendship so bad and why she values it so much. Because when Rimuru and Malene become best friends, she is loyal. It's to the point, it's like, why are you so loyal to this person, to this slime? You just met them. You're like this just because you're best friends. And after hearing her story, we now realize why she values friendship so much.
She was alone for a long time.
Yeah, she was.
The fact of how Rimuru knows how to kind of manipulate her, but it doesn't always work out. Like when there's an envoy from one of the Demon Lords coming to check out Rimuru, Malene fights them, knocks him out, and she expects to be rewarded. And Rimuru just reprimands her, like, okay, due to this, you've lost your dinner. And she flies off the wall, ready to go and kill the guy. Like, I've already lost my dinner, so what else is there? And then cut to the next scene where she's sat there eating a sandwich.
Her priorities, yo. Her priorities. Friendship first, food second.
The dynamic between Rimuru and Malim is quite interesting.
It's cute. It's a cute dynamic. And it's really funny because Rimuru is sort of like manipulating her, but in a endearing way.
I do think he genuinely sees her as a friend, but I also think it's one of those friends you don't want to piss off because you know what they're capable of.
Oh yeah, especially her. She could like wreck them.
Well, you saw that with what Malene was able to do to Charybdis.
Yeah, she like one-shot the fuck out of that thing.
This giant creature that everyone's worried about, and they think, it's after destroy it, but no, it's after Malene.
That was a long battle. Everyone thought they were gonna die, and then Malene came along and she's like,
just punches it and knocks it the fuck out,
right? It was like, Rimuru's like, I should have just had her fight from the beginning. They all thought they were gonna die. They're like, all right, this is our last moments. I love you all. I'm going to sacrifice myself.
And he just lets Malene let loose and
bunted him. Like, bye-bye. So there's that. And was it Tempest Federation? Is that what it was called?
The Jura Tempest Federation.
this federation here was created because the city was growing. They had, was it economic power now? Because they were trading, was it HP potions? They were trading...
Yeah, they were trading potions because Rimuru... It all started off at the city of Dwargon, where Rimuru was able to give potion that was incredibly pure. Because he was able to change the Hohokte herbs he was eating back.
So the herbs that Rimuru ate from this cave when he was blind, it was part of his slime body. And he was able to replicate his herbs into liquid form. I want to use the word excrete. Fluids! There you go. Release some fluids containing these herbs are 100% pure. And Rimuru,
the best that they could do was around 98?
So let's explain how pure this is. These HP potions that people had, like the best of the best, you know, could heal stuff, heal things. Rimuru's potion could regenerate limbs. That's how powerful it was, okay? Let's just say that's how high quality this was. And he was putting it on the market, so he was going to get some buka money. And so the kingdom that he interacted with before that had the his dwarf blacksmith, they wanted to have like agreement, a contract. And the king was saying, hey, your city is growing. It's becoming a country. You are a country. You need to establish yourself. That way you don't get invaded by others. And I will make an alliance with you. Rimuru is like, what? Now I have to run a country? Come on now. I already had a city. I try to appoint people to run the city so I can relax. Now we got a country? Oh, man. He's like, well, okay. Say this is a country. I do want to protect this, and I want to protect my peace. All right. We'll make it into a country. I'll make this alliance with you. You better not fuck with me, okay? Kingdom, don't mess with us. Otherwise, I will release Milim on you, okay? Okay?
Yeah. Well, how Gazelle tests if Rimuru, well, tests Rimuru's metal is with a fight. And it's the case, if you can survive this, you win. And the Dryad becomes the referee of the whole thing. And because the Dryad shows up, he knows that Rimuru is who he says he is and is respected to be able to do all this.
The Dryad has full authority of this forest, and whoever the Dryad trusts or appoints as a leader, there are no arguments to this. Dryad appointed Rimuru as leader, protector of the forest, the king. He accepts this, but he's still going to fight Rimuru, test him out, be like, hey, let's see if he can be a leader, worthy to be my partner. Partner? That's not a right word. Not a partner.
Well, someone that he wants to form a treaty with.
Yes!
And Rimuru does manage to survive. And as well as the treaty, Gazelle decides to also give Rimuru the... I've just remembered his name. His name's Vesta. Gives Rimuru Vesta, who is the person who caused the situation back at Dwargon. And Vesta, now knowing what he's done wrong, everything, apologizes to them both. And he is going to be the head of research, creating the HP potions at the cave where the Hohokte herbs are now being planted by the dragon newts. And Gabiru still cannot do anything correctly, even planting herbs.
That was funny. Can we talk about that character? So,
yay, Gabiru!
So these lizardmen, they have an interesting dynamic. The way the story portrays them are like Yankees, delinquents. It's hilarious. It totally reminds me of Yakuza or something like that.
Well, Gabiru thinks he's the shit, and he has three loyal followers. They just inflate his ego.
It's like, big bro, you're so awesome. Oh my gosh, you totally punched him so good. Big bro, we love you, big bro.
The first interaction that Gabiru has with Rimuru and his followers is wanting to speak to the head of the village and have a fight, because he's like, oh, you will join us or blah, blah, blah. And so they send out Gobta. And Rimuru's followers are well-trained. They know the martial arts and they know how to fight. And Gobta's your basic...
Gobta looks like a runt. He looks like the weakest of the bunch.
Gobita kicks the shit out of Gabiru.
So remember when we talked about evolution and like how some keep their original forms and some evolve into better physique, more beautiful, looking stronger? Gobita did not. He kept his goblin form. He looked so basic.
Gobita did not change at all, did he?
No, he looked so basic. So in this fight with Gabiru, Rimuru sends out Gobita.
And due to this, the fight, Gabiru assumes that Gobita is the true leader of the village and not this little slime.
Rimuru can turn into like a human form, but he prefers to like stay in his slime form because, you know, he's relaxing. And having that slime form was really beneficial for him because it deceived everyone. Everyone thought he was weak, but he's like, nope, I'm pretty powerful. So when I say deceive, people would think that he's weak, right? And they can take advantage of him. They talk down on him. And he's just taking it, you know? He just wants to make this peaceful, talk it out. But then it escalates. It escalates. And Rimuru's like, okay, I gotta take this in my own hands. I'm about to knock some sense into you people. Do not disrespect my people. You can disrespect me, but not my people. And I'm gonna show you why. Human form! Powers! Blasting fire and lightning. Pew, 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 pew. At one point,
he does actually introduce himself as your friendly neighborhood slime.
Yes! I'm just your friendly neighborhood slime. Teehee.
Another funny dynamic in the show is between Shion and Shuna, because they're both so in love with Rimuru, they both want to be around him all the time.
Oh, they keep
arguing about who gets to look after him.
They adore him. They idolize him.
Have you seen the OVAs for that yet?
Yeah, I did.
The one where they wanted a plushy Rimuru.
There's OVAs available to watch. We recommend that you guys watch it after you watch the anime. They're hilarious.
But before that, you need to listen to the podcast.
All right, so the Drua Tempest Federation has been established. It's been created. It has an ally of another kingdom to protect it. But then there are other kingdoms that see that there are resources there because there's this high-quality potion. There's trade routes now. Rimuru made roads. It is an amazing source of income. And so other countries, other territories are seeing this as, ooh, gold mine. Let's take this over. It's only run by monsters. We can take these monsters. They're evil anyway, because there's a prejudice to monsters, right? Of course, right? Typical. Anyways, they go to take over this territory, but the monsters are like, motherfucker. Nope, this is our home. Back off. They are proving themselves to be powerful. Then comes this, religious country? Oh, those bastards. This religious country is like, hey, let's take over this territory. Let's make some money and eradicate these monsters that we have prejudice against.
And that just kicked a whole can of worms.
Yeah, so Rimuru was actually someplace else when this was happening. He was at a school. Where was he?
He was teaching children who were summoned from another world.
Oh, so Shizu was a teacher at this academy, and she was teaching other children who were summoned to this world whose magic use was also haywire, and she was trying to find a way to save them.
Because if they didn't have their magic use saved, they would have died before the 10th birthday.
And so Rimuru was able to figure out by analyzing Shizu. He knows that she had Ifrit, which helped stabilize her magic use. So he was like, oh, let's get spirits to make contracts with these kids so their magic use could be stabilized. So there's a whole story of them looking for the spirit queen. Was it Queen of the Spirits? There's a whole story about that. And they find the Queen of the Spirits. And it turns out that she's a demon lord. It's like, wait, hold up. Aren't you supposed to be like a representative of good and light? How are you a demon lord? So that piques our interest. It's okay, it seems like demon lords can be made and anyone can be a demon lord. All right, we'll get back to the story later on. Back to the Spirit Queen. She had her own personality. What was her name?
I'm just saying Ramirez.
So Ramirez is a fairy queen.
former fairy queen.
Ramirez, she is still the fairy queen. A fallen fairy queen. She's a fallen fairy queen.
Former fairy queen.
Spirit says former, I say fallen.
Well, she's demon lord now, so she's no longer the fairy queen. She's former.
Will they still listen to her, the fairies? Can she have two titles?
Maybe.
All right. So we don't know what happened, but she has a fascination of technology. And the dwarves made this golem and they chucked it out because it wasn't working properly. But Ramirez found it. She was able to make it work by infusing it with spirits so it could function. That was like the power source, which let it move around certain ways. But then Rimuru just blew that sucker up. And Ramirez's like, no, my golem. I was so proud of this. And so Ramirez's like, okay, we're looking for the fairy queen. We need spirits to help these kids so they don't die. And so they're explaining everything. And Ramirez's like, I don't know. You guys destroyed my golem. I'm a demon lord. I should just eradicate you guys. And Ramirez's like, you're a demon lord. No. Aren't demon lords like Malim? And she's like, how do you know her? And Ramirez says, she's my best friend. And Ramirez says, you're her best friend? The best friend that she's been bragging about? Ooh! Apparently Ramirez and Malim have some beef, or it's more like on Ramirez's side. She's got some beef with her. So anyways, because Ramirez is that best friend, Ramirez is like, okay, I'll help you. I just do not sick Malim on me, okay? Just don't. I don't want to fight her. And Ramirez turns out to be pretty cool. She helps the kids. She introduces them to the spirits, tries to introduce them to high rank spirits, because the higher the rank, the more stabilized the kids will be. And it sort of introduces a potential arc for the kids. Because one of the kids becomes a hero. Another kid has this weird spirit from the future infused with her. And the other kids have pretty cool powers. You know, there's a lot of potential for arcs or spin-offs for these kids. Spin-off stories. So that's really interesting. That's fascinating. I'm excited for that.
Well, there's a couple of spin-off mangas, so they may do something around the line down that road.
Right? So it's like, ha ha ha, there might be spin-offs. Awesome. Anyways, so while all this is happening, the religious country is plotting to take over the Druid Tempest Federation. All kinds of stuff was happening inside the Druid Tempest Federation. They had this religious country attack them. This religious country has some OP summon heroes, not even heroes, they're evil people, summon humans to infiltrate and attack the monsters in the Druid Tempest Federation. Then we have this demon lord that implanted a spy and made that spy cancel out any magic powers used by monsters, which then gave the advantage to the religious country, and people died. Oh, that was heartbreaking. Oh, our lovable characters died. That whole section, arc, battle, whatever, it was sad. It was depressing. But, oh, the battle scenes were so good, especially when Rimuru showed up and he was just revenge. He was on revenge. Rimuru was so badass. Ugh. It was so good.
And due to a lot of his followers dying, including Shion, is why he decides to go through the process of becoming a demon lord. So he can bring back all of his fallen friends.
That scene where he infiltrates the camp and plots these reflective lights in the area. So when he shot out like this beam of light, it was just reflecting on these particles all over the area, directing this laser through people, killing them like one shot. And because it kept reflecting off the particles, killed everyone in the camp. It was amazing. It was like one of those moves where you think, why can't they just do this? Oh, he did it. He did that move. And then he gets the leader, the religious leader of that army, and he plays with them emotionally and psychologically. It's like, yes, torture them, make them suffer, make them repent. It was a juicy revenge. I was satisfied.
The whole situation does change Rimuru's personality a little bit because you see a much darker side to him than you have before. Like, even when coming down to defeat Geld, the Great Old Disaster, when he was speaking to him, he's like, look, I'm going to kill you. You know, I know you're going to die, but I'm going to look after your people. I'm going to take on all this. I'll make sure they're okay. This one, like, Rimuru's like, I'm going to kill all these. I'm going to become a demon lord. I'm going to bring them back. But it's how many people he had to kill to go through the process. Oh, I can't remember the number, but it was quite a high number. Something like 10,000 souls?
10,000, yeah. It was 10,000 souls.
So yeah, that's 10,000 people that had to die so he could become a demon lord. But that entire arc, you saw a much darker side to Rimuru.
Which I liked because it did portray in the story that it's not a happy-go-lucky story. There are dark features to it. And it also shows that Rimuru is pretty realistic.
The way it's portrayed and how you do see certain things play out in that time I was reincarnated as slime, I'd say it's a lot like Overlord.
Oh, yeah.
But a more friendly version. Like, you do see the like in both shows or manga, whichever you, or light novels, whichever you prefer, you get to see a political side of an overpowered character. And you get to see how they deal with certain situations and everything like that. It's one's a lot darker than the other. But that doesn't stop how it goes, but it's really interesting to see. Not just your happy-go-lucky side.
You know what's interesting? So when you said powerful, overpowered character, so Rimuru, we didn't know how powerful he was until he met that limit. And when I say limit, I mean that limit of tolerance. So Rimuru is being tolerable. He's like, hey, we're going to talk this out. Oh, you don't want to talk it out? You want to fight? Okay, sure, I'll defend myself. Oh, you hurt my friends. Okay, I'm going to protect my friends and eradicate you. You never know the extent of his power until he's being provoked. And in this arc, it shows us how far he would go.
The way he fought and made sure he got his friend back, he fought as if he had nothing to lose.
Right.
He still had thousands of other followers and everything like that, but all he focused on was the ones that were dead. And they were coming back. No ifs or buts about that situation. He was doing anything he could to bring those back. And becoming a demon lord was that option. Due to that, 10,000 people had to die.
And also, there was that risk of him being a demon lord, becoming a demon lord that was different from who he actually was. And in case that did happen, he did tell, who was it exactly? Benimaru?
Benimaru. Yeah, Benimaru. He said, if I come out and I'm not me, kill me.
Right. And so we were all like, no, I hope you don't turn out like that. Then the process of becoming a demon lord happened. And then we see what's happening inside Rimuru. And we see the Great Sage. And the Great Sage is evolving too. And that's what we were talking about earlier. Yeah, he evolves into Raphael. And it's like, wait, we didn't know you could evolve. We just thought you were the Great Sage, you know, the whole high being. We didn't know you could evolve. Like, how much could you evolve? Can you evolve something higher later on? What are you hiding, huh? Great Sage, what are you hiding? No, not hiding. More like, what else is your potential that we don't know about?
Well, that's the ultimate skill. That's the highest. Well, as far as we know, that's the highest a skill can go. When Rimuru does first come back after the demon lord transformation, you cannot tell if it is actually Rimuru because there is sort of like an autonomous nature about him.
Oh, I thought that was Raphael possessing his body, like taking control.
I believe, I believe it was, but I'm just but what I mean is that you can't tell if it's actually or what it is, or his followers can't, because Rimuru was just going about very robotically and distant.
Meaning they weren't too sure if they were supposed to kill him because his personality changed, or
they couldn't tell if that was Rimuru or if it was something else, like if it was his new nature. During the demon lord process, three demons were also summoned, and two had to sacrifice themselves for the ritual to bring back everyone, and only one survived that process, and that was who is now Diablo, who looks very much like Sebastian from Black Butler.
He does, and you know what? He became a butler. After Rimuru becomes a demon lord, everyone is revived, and apparently they're not just revived, they're reincarnated. And when they're reincarnated, they are able to get an ability, and that's where Shion gets her ability to cook now. That's what Spirit was talking about earlier.
Yeah, her food still looks atrocious and like it's going to kill you, but it's now edible.
So Shion likes to cook, but she was really bad at cooking. It looked horrible. It looked like some demonic sludge. And everyone knew about it, but when it was introduced, Rimuru was like, yeah, I can eat anything. I'm a predator. And he eats Shion's food, and it's disgusting. He's like, I'm never going to have her cook again. But she loves to cook. And she knows she's bad at cooking. So when she got reincarnated, she was finally able to cook something that Lord Rimuru loves. Because when Rimuru was a slime, he couldn't taste anything. Then he got the human form from Shizu, and he was finally able to taste. He had a tongue that had a palate. He was excited to eat things, and then he ate Shion's food, and he's like, oh, this is disgusting. And now Shion can give him delicious food that look disgusting.
And it further perpetuates, well, I can see it doing it, further perpetuating the rivalry between Shion and Shuna.
Question is, Spirit, why do you like that time I was reincarnated as a slime?
Well, first time I watched it, I didn't like it. I started watching the first episode, and I was like, oh, this is just going to be another isekai. And, oh, it's a slime, this is going to be stupid, I'm not going to enjoy this in the slightest. So the first time I watched it, I didn't even make it through the first full episode. And what I normally do when I'm watching an anime or reading a manga, I'll watch 5 episodes, or a manga I'll read maybe 3 or 4 chapters just to see what I gauged. But this time I didn't even watch the first full episode. I was like, oh, I can't stand this, I don't like it. But one day I was bored and I just decided to actually sit down and watch it. And I ended up watching like 7 or 8 episodes in a go. And it just draws you in, the fact of it's not just your typical isekai.
It's not.
There is a story about it. Yeah, the character's overpowered and everything. And it does start off thinking, oh, it's going to be your typical isekai, or overpowered characters, which is, it's overdone. It's overplayed. But when you get to see the development of the characters, you get to see the political situations, there is actually a background in it. You get to see how Rimuru is impacting the world, and also how the world's impacting on Rimuru. You get to see interactions with certain characters. You get to see how this little slime is able to create something which is benefiting all the monsters. The fact that he saved these kids from dying. The fact that another kid that was summoned over one time, who's high up in a city, who was taught by... Shizu. And the fact that Rimuru creates manga for him because he's read this manga that this kid was reading when he was back on Earth. Just the interactions of certain characters. It has its dark moments, which I do enjoy in the show, because it's not all fluff.
Mm-hmm.
But certain moments that happen in it are done incredibly well. Like when you see what happens with Shizu and when she's dying. Mm-hmm. And asks Rimuru to eat her. And the final moments, she gets to see her. She's reunited with her mom. The fact of like I say, Rimuru saving those kids, helping the ogres. When he gets to talk to Geld after he's devoured him and saying, look, I'm going to kill you. You're dying. I know you are. But I will help you people. I will make sure they are looked after. I will do everything. And the fact of the Geld who's dying is crying, saying, how greedy are you, the way that you can even eat away my sins. And during the trial, Rimuru even says, I've taken on Geld's things. If you're going to do anything, I'm the one to blame. I'm taking on these responsibilities. The fact of the impact he's having, I just think it's quite a poignant way that they're showing this sort of stuff. And it's kind of like why Overlord is also one of my favorite anime light novels. It shows you stuff beyond the characters. It shows you the political sides. It's showing you how impactful these characters are being and impacting the world around them. It's not just your typical overpowered character in another world. And that's why I really enjoy it.
That was really good.
Yeah, so why do you enjoy this story?
Why do I enjoy that time I was reincarnated as a slime?
Yes, why do you enjoy Tensei no Slime Dataken?
I enjoy the story because I can't predict anything. I love to predict things in the stories. And this one, I never know what's going to happen. So, for example, the story starts out as a slime. He gets reincarnated as a slime. I did not expect that. And I was really curious about it. I was like, okay, how are you going to make a story about a slime? Really? A slime? But I wanted to see how it went. I wanted to see where the story was going to go. And then they introduce a dragon. It's like, okay, a dragon. All right. And he eats the dragon. I'm like, okay, I wasn't expecting that. All right. And then he becomes a leader of monsters. All right. Did not expect that either. There's so many surprises. I love it. I love when there's surprises in stories. I love when it's not predictable. And then, like, everything you're talking about, when he goes to that academy, he encounters that kid that was taken care of by Shizu. I didn't see that coming. I was like, wait, there's another summoned person? What? And Rimuru being able to replicate the manga that the kid likes to read. I didn't see that coming either. I was like, wait. You can replicate stuff from memory? Hold up, Rimuru. Wait, hold on. This changes everything. And then just these instances happening one after another, directing Rimuru into making this civilization. I didn't expect that either. I thought, you know, he's just going to have an adventure, travel around the world. But no, he's creating this country. And every character that's introduced becomes a contribute to this country, to this civilization. And it's like they're trying to make the slime be like a revolutionary aspect of this world. Like at the end, when Rimuru becomes a demon lord, I thought he was so against the demon lord aspect. He's like, no, I don't want to be a demon lord. I don't want to be a hero. I don't want that responsibility. But because he really wanted to bring back the people he loved, he was willing to do it. Okay, now he's a demon lord. Now what? He's like, okay, demon lord claiming,
I'm coming for you.
Yeah, Demon Lord claiming he's the reason why this is happening. He manipulated it. We're going to go war against him. I did not expect that. I did not expect Rimuru to initiate war. I'm like, dang, Rimuru, your peaceful days are over. You are taking initiative. That is hot. Okay. And then we kind of forgot about Veldora, the dragon. We forgot about Veldora. He releases Veldora. And we're like, what? He's being released now? Oh my gosh.
During this time, around 2 years has passed. He's been in the world around 2 years.
And then, okay, so Veldora he's a dragon, right? So we're like, okay, he has to be able to hang out with Rimuru. How is he going to do that? And Rimuru's like, hey, here's my clone. It's like, what? Are you serious? You're just going to give him a clone of yourself? And I'm like thinking, okay, Veldora better not look like Rimuru because we can't have two Rimurus. We cannot. And when Veldora possesses the clone, he changes
inhabits.
So when Veldora inhabits the clone, he customizes it to match with Veldora's personality and it looks different, but yet similar to Rimuru. So I was like, oh, I love these surprises.
And the fact that it's like, how the hell are you talking like this? And Veldora's been reading manga from Rimuru's memories while he's been inside him.
And throughout all this, there's just so much humor. There's a lot of humor in this story.
Also interesting, they've taken what is usually seen as the weakest enemy in a video game, your typical slime, and made it the central character.
And with this story, it just gets more intricate. Every time when they introduce characters, it gets more intricate. It's like they're expanding the world. So we encountered that kingdom with where the dwarves were from. We encountered that human kingdom. And then the religious kingdom. It's like, okay, what else is over here? What else? And then they bring in demon lords. Okay, what else is there? It's like, it's limitless. We never know what's going to happen next, except that there's going to be demon lord wars. That's it. We know that.
Moral of the story is go and watch or read that, this story. And for the listeners, the poor question of the day is, what's your favorite Isekai anime? Mine currently is Overlord.
If the platform allows it, share your story in the comments. And if not, there is a Discord. There's a Discord link available in the description. It's really easy. Just click on it. And there is the Podcast Across Worlds thread, which also has the PAW question available. And from there, you can answer and share your story and share your enthusiasm. I'm Lehua Superfina, host of Podcast Across Worlds. You can find me on all social media platforms at Lehua Superfina. Weekly, I upload videos about video games, manga, and candy masks on youtube.com/LehuaSuperfina. I also stream every Tuesday, Thursdays, and Saturdays on twitch.tv/LehuaSuperfina.
Hi, I'm Spirit Shot, co-host of Podcast Across Worlds and also content creator, streamer on the channel you'll find in the description. And one of the upcoming shows is Tinfoil Talks, where we deep dive into bullshit in video gaming. We take a topic and we find out how it got there, why it's there, come up with some excuse until we believe it ourselves, and then put it out into the stratosphere.
And that concludes our episode of Podcast Across Worlds. Thank you all for tuning in. Keep reading manga, keep watching anime, and keep listening to Podcast Across Worlds. We'll see you on the next episode. Since you're still here, how about leaving a like? And while you're at it, subscribe, ring the bell so you can get notifications. I want to give a huge, huge shout out to my Patreons and channel members because you all have been supporting the Superfina channel and it's not even required. So I really appreciate you. You are all in my heart. If you also want to support the Superfina channel, here's a link to the Patreon, along with a list of social media. All the links are available in the description below. Thank you so much for watching this video. I have much love, much aloha for y'all, and I will see you later.